Thank you. your loving kindness renewing us day by day. We need to be able to see you. Father, in this world that we're living in right now, sometimes it becomes difficult for us to see your hand in all things. But Father, we recognize right now that you are in all things because all things were created through you. So Father, right now as we're praying, we're asking that you would open the eyes of our heart so that nothing would be in the way, nothing would be in our vision. We'll be able to see that greater is he that is with us than he that is in the world. We'll be able to look and see the different stages of our lives where you've kept us, guided us, directed us, and made sure that we didn't fail and falter, God. When we would have destroyed ourselves, God, you saw fit to keep us. So open the eyes of our heart so that we can see you. Father, as we go into the furtherance of this service, we ask that all people that are here right now would allow their eyes and their hearts and their ears to be open to receive what you have prepared. Father, we honor you and we worship you at this day and in this hour and in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. You can take your seats at this time. Amen. We got a couple of quick announcements we want to get into. First off, Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day. To all the mothers who are here, physical mothers, spiritual mothers, you may not have children, but you may have somebody that call you mom because you've been a guiding force and a guiding factor. You may have, I know when my mother was living, everybody called her mom because that was the house everybody came to when they got kicked out everywhere else. Amen? You know, we had a huge area and we always had that extra bedroom because somebody was always getting kicked out for something. And that's where they would come, was to our house. And then my mother would call and say, hey, you know, I got your kid over here. He all right, we're going to feed him dinner, and they're going to chill out for a little bit, and I'll bring him back around 7. That was the standard, okay, because that's what a mother does. A mother nurtures. A mother develops. A mother is in a position to where she can care for other people. Amen? So, again, Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers. We thank you for all that you do. I got a quick little video to see if we're going to let it play. One of y'all connected to Bluetooth. Can one of y'all disconnect from Bluetooth? That would be you. Thank you, sir. Greatly appreciate you kindly. So we have a video that we want to play that they won't play it on Facebook, but I really enjoy it and it honors what mothers do. One of you is still connected. I gotta play the video for you. There you go. Again, just wanna honor. And this is what happens when tardiness occurs. You never get started the way you want to. You don't get a chance to check anything. Here we go.
She's born in this world. Sometimes I need. Amen. We celebrate you. Amen. We celebrate you. People say, well, that's not a gospel song, but that's about your mama. Amen. So that kind of supersedes, and we know that we honor all mothers in this place. Now, a couple of quick announcements that we want to get into, and then we have some acknowledgments. Before we get into the announcements, we have two things I need you to be in prayer for support for. Two things I need you to be in prayer for support. Sister Letitia lost her sister on this past week, and we're working through the processes now. You know, so if you have a moment in your prayer here, or if you want to reach out to her directly, please, by all means, make sure you pray with her, because losing a sibling is difficult. Losing a sibling is difficult. Amen. Second thing, Deacon Sandy is recuperating. She had a medical emergency, so she is recuperating at this time. You were in the leadership meeting, you know what happened. But she is recuperating at this time, and just by all means, please keep her in your prayers during this time. Self-care is important. Here's what I do want to share with you. You have to always be of the mindset that if you can't compartmentalize everything, then you have to get rid of something, okay? Because stress is a very dangerous thing. If you can't compartmentalize something, then if you can't compartmentalize everything, you have to get rid of something. And the most important thing to recognize in that time is, because God only gives us 24 hours in each day, the day is divided into three parts. You have a part for your work and the things that you do just in general, you know, throughout your day to day, or if you work nights, throughout your nights. You have 8 hours to care for family and to relax and to do the things that you need to do. But then you have 8 hours for rest. And if you're not resting, if you're not putting things in its proper perspective to where things overrun into each other, then you're not doing honor to the day that God has given you. Amen? So take care of yourself and make sure that you're doing well. A couple of quick announcements. The letter has already gone out. I did take care of that. For our fourth church anniversary, our guest is going to be Pastor Curtis Scrivens, the True Vine Missionary Baptist Church, 3:00. They'll be here next week. As I always say, nothing is worse than having somebody come to your house and you're not home. So let's make sure. I understand some people are with their mothers on Mother's Day at, you know, different ministries, or, you know, maybe they had to go out of town. So I get that. Next week is church anniversary. Be here. Amen. Be here. Friday Faith Phillips, we're working on those. You know, my schedule changed. So 7 a.m., I'm trying to get everything loaded and get everything in order to be able to go from there. And that's taking a little bit of time. So we're still working on that process. Okay. And hand-in-hand distribution, we want to make sure you know that there are things going on always in the church, and that there is a distribution we do each week. We do each week. Amen. And it's, you have to be mindful of that. We care for our community. All right. And we're working at that. Sunday worship experience, 10 a.m. to 11:30 at a maximum. We're here every week, 10 a.m. And we want to make sure that people are aware. Okay. Mondays, you will not find us here. Church offices are closed, except by special appointment. We're not going to be here because we're here on Sundays. Tuesday night transformation. Tuesdays at 6:30. We are doing 6:30. The door is open. 6:45 is corporate prayer, and it starts at 7 p.m. Amen. Baptism services every fourth Sunday of each month. We want to make sure that we have all of that in order and in process. Fasting and prayer, first Friday of each month. And we recognize that some things only come through fasting and through prayer. Amen. Amen. Communion Sunday, first Sunday of each month. Now, we do have special presentations on this morning that we want to be exceptionally mindful of. We want to be exceptionally mindful of. One of the things that we have, you know, being a not a traditionally jurisdictional or denominational church, but being a traditional church in the way of honoring where honor is due. Amen? So we have a couple of presentations we want to work on. And we want to make sure that everyone is aware that as these individuals that are set for presentation come forward, that they will handle it in their own way. So let's welcome them as they come. Amen. Amen. Mm-hmm. Need some help with that. Amen. Let me explain to you what's going on. So being a traditionally minded, but though not a denominationally minded church, we have a church mother. A church mother has the responsibility, when she's got to a certain age where she is a trusted voice, where she is pouring into the women of the ministry, and you know, mainly just making sure that things flow in a way as a mother would do. The first lady of the church, while not a church mother, is a mother nonetheless. So we would be remiss in ministry, and this is what I always want to teach, we would be remiss in ministry to not honor both or to honor one without the other because of how important the two work hand in hand. So as we began to work through everything, so y'all ever remember me telling you the story about, you know, how she almost talked herself out of her engagement ring? I'll tell y'all that later. So what ends up happening, if you know Pastor L, then you got an idea where I'm talking. So that's the thing is, if we would be remiss did we not honor both. Amen. So I thank you, Connected Family, for making sure that both were taken care of. Especially, you know, like I said, the only people that know when I'm sick are those two. Okay? Them the only ones that know are those two. And guess where it stays? With those two. Amen? Because don't nobody else know. You know? They're the ones that really know what's going on with me from day to day. So we honor both of you. We honor all mothers. And please, you know, after service, we do have a special gift for you. Don't run out. You know, if you're wearing heels, you should know, don't run out so quickly that your heel gets caught in the grate and puts you on stop. Oh, I forgot. I got to get on. You try to take off, didn't you? When Jesus says no, she tried to take off and got her heel caught. She was like, I thought you was going to ask me something, but if I was, you stuck now. You can't go nowhere. Stop trying to run off. Amen. So we honor mothers in this place. Let's get ready to bless the Lord through giving. If you need an envelope, I'm going to ask that you would raise your hand. If you didn't get one when you came in, if you're giving online, please, ma'am, please, sir, make sure you're filling out an envelope for the end of the year tax services. We have switched over our service so that we'll be able to generate a report either weekly, quarterly, etc. It works out a lot easier than having to try to go back and filter everybody's stuff and print 75 tax forms at the end of the month to where, you know, we typically will tell people if your charitable contribution is more than, let's say, $20 or $30, you know, then yes, we're going to go ahead and request that you get a tax form. If your charitable contribution is $1, $5, if you're in second grade or first grade, you know, we're not going to print you out a tax form, you know, even though her giving has been more consistent than some other people. Amen? Amen. Y'all shouldn't be laughing at that. No, I'm just saying. So let's get ready to bless the Lord through giving. Let's go ahead and grab the basket. Yes, sir. Amen. I always tell Jalen, you can dress yourself during the week, but on Sundays I get to dress you. You know, so that's the agreement he and I have. On Sundays I get to dress him, so it's always a great thing. Amen. Come on up. But just like any little boy, she would just run around untied. Hopefully you ain't got to run from no dog or nothing. Just be tripping everywhere. Let's put our seed in our right hand, the hand of blessing. Let's get ready to bless the Lord. Amen. Father, we thank you in this hour for being able to sow seed into good ground. We ask you that you allow it to be returned according to your will and according to your way. There are some that are expecting a blessing and they're sowing on faith, God. So don't allow their faith to come back empty, God. Allow their faith to be made manifest through their deed and then through your blessing. Father, we honor you in this place that this is good ground, that we're in a position to where your blessings flow freely. Father, bless those who are in need of a special anointing and a special prayer on this morning, God. We ask that you would have your way in their lives and show that you are still in control of all things. We honor you, we bless you, we adore you, and we worship you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may come sow your seed. If you are giving online and trying to figure that out, it's displayed up top, so you'll be able to see that. Givelify, Text to Give, Cash App, you know, are all displayed up there. Are we able to see that up there? That's kind of blurry, isn't it? Is it just me? So if you're texting give, it's 315-270-3313. You text the word give and your dollar amount. Cash App is $ Get Connected SYR. Givelify is the Connected Church. Or you can go right to our website and sow directly from there. I do encourage you, as Christians, our obligation is to, to make sure that the things of God are being honored. One of the ways we do that is through giving. We don't manufacture widgets. We haven't killed any chickens, nor pulled no fish out the sea in order to keep things going. So as a ministry, we survive by the charitable contribution of individuals such as yourself and such as us. We sow our seed, and we anticipate that the example will trickle down, right? We just have to make sure that people are aware. This is not just, people will say, well, Jesus did away with the tithe, right? But there's no getting around giving. There's no getting around giving. People will say, oh, well, I don't do this or I don't do that. Let me share this with you. When your life goes topsy-turvy, you need God. You need to honor the mandates of God. And just as I can tell you, you can't beat God giving. When you need him, he honors those who honor his word. So I encourage you, please, ma'am, please, sir, if you've never given, today is the day. Today is the day. Some of us are blessed exponentially and are extremely tight with a dollar. And won't bless the Lord. And I encourage you, there's no more excuses going forward. It's just not. The time for excuses are done. I would say what my mama said, it's Mother's Day, but mama wasn't always, she ain't always say things in a churchly way. But she just said, excuses are very common amongst everyone in certain ways. There are certain parts of your body that everyone still has. And when it comes down to it, everyone has one, just like everyone has an excuse, and there are times when both of them stink. So I'll let you figure that out in Jesus' name. I told you, I have to clean up some things. I don't even know how to clean up some of the stuff she said, but, we got to clean up some things. So we're going to get ready to go into the Word of God on this morning. Amen? We want to thank Brother Jason for sitting in with us. He's making good time. We're still in good time for you to get to your next location. And Brother Calvin is with one of his friends that's graduating down in Alabama that took a little bit longer to graduate than anticipated, so we celebrate. If you're on a six-year plan at a four-year college, we celebrate that, amen, because at least you graduated. If you're on a seven-year plan at OCC, at least you got your degree, amen? Amen. Sometimes you got to start, stop, and life gets in the way. So that's where we're at. But we're going to get ready to bless the Lord through the Word of God this morning. We're going to talk about the hallmarks of a godly mother. The hallmarks of a godly mother. If you have your Bibles, I'm going to ask you to open up to the second chapter of John in verse number 1. And I'm going to ask you that you will rest on your feet for this particular portion. And then we'll give you some key scriptures out of Proverbs 31 and 10. But 2 John and the first chapter says this, the elder, to the elect lady and her children, I love all of you in the truth. And not only I, but also all who have come to know the truth. Keep your hand there. We're going to jump over to Proverbs, the 31st chapter, familiar portions of scripture. We're going to take a couple of verses. I don't want to go all the way through, so I actually took off two verses at the end, and that was it. It says, who can find a virtuous woman for a price is far above rubies? The heart of her husband does safely trust in her, so that he shall have no need of spoil. She will do him good and not evil all the days of her life. She seeks wool and flax and worketh willingly with her hands, and she is like the merchant ship. She brings her food from afar. She rises while it is still yet night and gives meat to her household and a portion to her maidens. She considers a field and buys it with the fruit of her hand. She plants a vineyard. She girds her loins with strength and strengthens her arms. She perceives that her merchandise is good, and her candle goeth not out by day. She lay her hands on the spindle, and her hands hold the distaff. She stretched out her hands to the poor, and she reaches forth her hands to the needy. She's not afraid of the snow for her household, because all of her household are clothed with scarlet. She makes herself coverings of tapestry. Her clothing is silk and purple. Her husband is known at the gates when he sits among the elders of the land. She makes fine linen and sells it and delivers girdles unto the merchant. Strength and honor are her clothing, and she shall rejoice in the time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and her tongue is the law of kindness. She looks well to the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children arise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praises her. Many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excelleth them all. For a thought today, if I could give you a couple of key points out of this particular text, and it says the hallmarks of a godly mother. Let us pray. Father, we thank you yet again for our life, health, and strength. We thank you for the opportunity to come here to hear a word that you have prepared for us on this morning, God. We ask that nobody leave the same way that they came in. We ask that as we listen to this, as we receive this, that we will internalize this. Show us where we have areas of opportunity. And Father, let us recognize where we're doing things well. Father, we honor you. Allow me to decrease, that the power of your word would increase in this place. That your words and your life and your anointing would show forth and not me. Let me not be seen, but you only. As I stand behind this, your sacred desk, have your way. In Jesus' name, amen. You may take your seats at this time. Saints, I want to share a few things with you by way of understanding an announcement. When you look at 2 John, the first chapter, there's a letter that's written, you know, and this is written by John. John was the disciple that would always name himself as the one that Jesus loved. Amen? He was always the one that Jesus loved. This was written at a time when both Paul and Peter had already made their transitions. Because John was younger, he looked at things from a different perspective. Paul began to talk to the church. Peter began to talk to the law and governing of the church. But John spoke to the people. He spoke to families, he spoke about mothers, he spoke about children. John had a different perspective because as he walked with Jesus, he was a bit younger than everybody else, so he had a different perspective. He was developed and grew in nurturing through the time with Jesus. He was still yet a young man. So when he begins to talk about this letter that he sent out to this particular woman who had children, who had gotten to a point where she was now elect, she was now select, she was now above a few other people. And the reason why it's important is because he singularly chose her to send this letter to. And he chose her because God had blessed her. He had blessed her with sons. He had blessed her with children. He had blessed her in such a way, and she had done well according to Proverbs. When you look in Proverbs, this is how you get to that 2 John experience, is through a Proverbs preparation. You begin to look at it, and she was an elect lady who people loved. Very similarly to the mother of the church, or the first lady of the church, or any mother that pours into the young women, you can see God working in their lives. So as he wrote this letter, he wanted to make sure that there was no question, no compromise, that there was nothing that stood in the way of people understanding why he was writing. It's because she had done well. A godly mother is a mother to be exemplified. A godly mother is a mother to be elevated. A godly mother writes her own eulogy when it comes time for God to call her home. A godly mother is one that stands in the face of adversity. A godly mother is one that no matter what the world throws at her, she's able to stand up. So when you look at the hallmarks of a godly mother, I want to give you a few examples out of this text, if that's all right with you. I want to share with you just a couple of things, if that's all right with you. I don't want to go too deep into it because somebody waiting to try to rush to a brunch somewhere, they're trying to get over to exclusives, they're trying to get the Golden Corral ham and egg brunch or what have you, and some people got other things going on in their lives. So if it's all right with you, I just want to give you just a little bit this morning. Is that all right? Can I just talk to you briefly about what it means to be a godly mother? Can I talk to you briefly about this woman in Proverbs that was given as an example? Now, I need you to understand that we always equate this as a woman writing this, but this is actually for a father teaching his son what to look for when he looks for a wife. Amen? What he looks for. See, we got the whole Bible upside down and twisted, and we try because, you know, here's the thing. We'll twist things to try to fit what we think is right. We'll twist it just enough. The enemy did that. You know that because he told Jesus as he was up on the mountain, he said, you know, if you really be the Son of God, I know you're hungry. You ain't ate in 40 days. Turn these rocks into bread. And he says, man should not live by bread and bread alone. So the enemy will twist it. And there's so many of us that will twist the Bible enough to fit our own misconceptions, our own ideations, our own issues, our own problems. But the Bible is not designed for you to twist. As a matter of fact, in Revelation, it says that no man shall remove or change any jot or tittle of the Bible lest they have a millstone tied around their neck and cast it to the sea of forgetfulness. That's your Bible. Don't be fearful of it, but understand, don't change nothing to fit your craziness. Amen? So let me give you a little something when we begin to talk about in Proverbs. Amen? I want to go back a little bit just so you can understand exactly what we're talking about. It says, who can find a virtuous woman? Who can find a woman who is operating in a way that people would admire? Who can find somebody? Who can find a godly mother that somebody could be proud of? Who can look at a woman and say, you know what? That's somebody that has relationship with God. God's grace and mercy rests on her life. God has blessed her in a particular way. Who can find that woman? Because here's the thing. At the time, rubies were more valuable because they're rarer than diamonds. So that meant that above all, her value was greater than the most valuable stone. See, can I just share something with you real quick? Okay, all the men, can I just share something with you? If you ever plan on getting engaged, see, there's a company called De Beers. And De Beers got y'all messed up. Amen. De Beers said because they were losing money because diamonds were so plentiful in the areas that they were mining and that they had no business in to begin with because it wasn't their area. De Beers said, we're losing money, so we need to put a rush and say that diamonds are a girl's best friend. But the Bible says that a virtuous woman's price is above rubies. The diamonds were so plentiful in that area that you could just give them to your kids to play with, right? So they put a rush and they got you thinking that diamonds are the most valuable, but it's actually one of the most plentiful stones. They just control the market on it. But the Bible tells you that it doesn't say that a woman's value is above diamonds because they're really of no value. That when you look at it, a woman's value is above rubies because rubies were rarer. Rubies represented the blood, and when you look at it, her price is far above that. The heart of a husband trusts in her. So I don't like reality TV, and the reason being, it seems like everybody doing something that ain't nobody got no business doing, especially married couples on TV, right? Now, I would be a complete mess if I was a reality show husband, because at all times I would be on guard thinking something is going on. But here's the thing, the Bible says that a husband who has a virtuous woman's heart trusts in that woman. He has no need to go anywhere else because she's virtuous. Because there's no question, because there's no issue. She's going to do him good and not evil all the days of her life. So when we begin to look at what it takes to be an elect mother, to be an elect woman, to be an elect lady, to be a virtuous woman, as talked about in this, as a hallmark of a godly mother, one of the things that as you get involved in your marriages and as you get involved in your long-term relationships that should end in marriage, I don't know what we practice them for 10, 15, 20 years, but these are the things we begin to look at. Your job, your role, your responsibility is to do good to your husband. See, somebody got to speak on it, because see, Kevin Sands was gone. So one of us got to speak on it. Dale was like, no, he didn't. Yes, I did. I'm going to give you a couple of quick truths. She rises while it is still yet night. She gets up and take care of what needs to be taken care of for the family. She gives meat to her household. But here's the thing. You know, you can't always just think about your house. A good godly mother recognizes that she has a role of responsibility to her community. Can I be honest about that? That's why we have so many, you know, we don't have as many as we used to have, but we used to have neighborhood mothers. Anybody know what a neighborhood mother could whoop you when your mama wasn't around and you couldn't do nothing about it? Because she did it in such a way because she cared for your safety. Amen? I grew up at 115 Stewart Court in Pioneer Homes. At any given time, Octavia, my mama, and one other, and Joey mama could whoop any one of us, whoever was home first, if we got out of line. And the reason being is because a godly mother cares for her community. It's not just about her household, but she cares for her household, but she takes care of those that are connected to her. Amen? We're talking about the hallmarks of a godly mother. She considers the fields and buys it with the fruit of her hands. She plants a vineyard. A godly mother ensures that there's no reason for lack. A godly mother will make sure that she looks at something. She says, I think this is going to be good for the upliftment and the betterment of my family and those connected to me in the community. See, a godly mother cares about the community. Amen? A godly mother is not just wrapped into her own skull. A godly mother cares about the community. This is what we begin to see in this particular portion of text. She's strong. She guards up her loins and she strengthens her arms. She recognizes that what she puts out is good. Let me just stop right there. People don't seem to understand, because we've done a horrible job of uplifting our mothers, our women, and they have a mindset that what they're doing is not good enough. But I'm here to tell you today that what God has placed on the inside of you, what God is developing within you, what God is nurturing within you is good enough. You are good enough. You are the righteousness of God. As a godly mother, if you're doing and operating in the purpose that God has set aside for you, you are more than enough. You are more than enough. Tap yourself on the chest, ladies, and say, I'm more than enough. I don't care what he said about me. I'm more than enough. I don't care what I said about myself. I'm more than enough. I don't care what I believed at one time, but I am more than enough. Oh, I don't hear you talking to yourself. Sometimes you have to encourage yourself. Sometimes you have to speak a word over yourself. Sometimes you look for encouragement to come from the outside, but encouragement needs to come from the inside. Sometimes you look at life and you say, well, they didn't tell me this, but I'm here to tell you today, you got to speak it over yourself. If you're not getting it, speak it over yourself. Your merchandise is good. You are blessed. You are the righteousness of God. You are a jewel in his crown. That's why our women's ministry is called Connected Jewels, because you are a jewel in God's crown. You were created for a purpose, and that purpose is to bring him glory. We get sidetracked, sidelined, run astray, led astray, run amok, all of these other things, because we listen to people that don't mean us no good. We let people tear us down. I'm talking to the ladies particularly. Men, our day is in June, but I need to encourage somebody today that just because they said it about you doesn't mean it was about you. Just because they told you you wasn't valuable didn't mean you didn't have value. Just because they told you, I don't know why you're here, didn't mean you didn't have purpose. Just because they walked away, baby, they did you a favor by walking away, because had they stayed in that position, they would have dragged you down. So you need to recognize on this Mother's Day that you are more than enough. You got value. Tap yourself and say, I have value. I have value. I don't see everybody talking, so here's the thing. Let me go a little bit deeper into this process. As we begin to look in the text, we begin to see exactly what it says. Your candle doesn't go out by day, not because you're always working, but sometimes you got to get before the Lord in the midnight hour. Sometimes ain't nobody else doing it. You got to get on your knees and say, it's me, oh Lord, and I'm standing in the need of prayer. Sometimes you got to cry out on behalf of your family. Sometimes you got to stand in the gap. Sometimes you're the one that has to be the prayer warrior when your prayer warrior is down and out. I'm talking to somebody today. Sometimes it's got to be you. So when that midnight hour comes, your candle is not going out. And the reason being is because you are putting yourself in a position to where God can work through you.
As you begin to look at it, you put your work in. You lay hands to the spindle, which means that you're creating a tapestry. You're creating an environment for your family. You're putting yourself in position to where your family is covered. Now, here's the thing. Can I share this with you? Here's where we made a mistake. So many of us have gotten with men that can't cover us, so we have to cover. Can I just be honest right now? There's so many women that have gotten with men that are not in a position where they can pray for you, where they can pray over you, where they can cover you. And the thing is, covering, and me and Pastor L talk about this from time to time, as we look at different ministries and we look at different people and we look at our lives, covering doesn't come at the level of your convenience. Covering comes at God's dictate and his mandate. That's where covering comes in at. So many women have gotten with men that can't even cover them on the base amounts. You done went out and bought them a PS5, he can't buy you a Happy Meal. I told you, Kevin gone. Somebody gotta talk about it. You want these high value men showing up, and you got on some pink sweatpants, say pink, and the eye going off the backside, and just say on the back of it, and a headscarf and everything, and what's underneath the headscarf ain't yours, and this is the thing, but you want to get to a position where you want covering, but there's women who are actually valuable, who recognize their purpose in the Lord, and they've gotten with these men, and they put themselves in a position to where these men have torn them down, have broken them down to the very last compound, and gotten them to a position to where they don't feel the value, and they've had to cover themselves. That's why it says, she lays hands to the spindle, and her hands hold the distaff. It covers her and her children. But this woman's got covering. She got a good husband. Amen? She stretches out her hand to the poor. She reaches forth her hands to the needy. Again, a good godly woman, a good godly mother is not just concerned about her household, but how can I be a blessing to those around me? How can I make change in my community? How can I shift things around in such a way that people around me will be able to feel the compassion of Christ just as I felt the compassion of Christ? What can I do to be a blessing? She reaches out her hands to the needy. She's not afraid of the snow because all her household is clothed with scarlet, meaning we've been covered by the blood of Jesus. She's not afraid of what comes in the cold and in the midnight hour because she's praying and she's fasting and she's working and she's reading her text and she's doing what needs to be done. So when those storms of life come, whether it be rain or snow, everybody is covered. So we're talking about a godly woman. We're talking about a godly mother. Amen. She makes coverings of tapestry. And her clothing is silk and purple. Now, let me explain to you something about clothing and purple and silk. When you begin to look at this, this was written in an area and in a time frame where silk was not plentiful. So what had to happen is they had to wait for the merchant ships to come from the Orient, as they used to call it back in the day, because they had trade routes, to bring silk, which was spun by silkworms. It wasn't none of this rayon, polyester, wasn't no sheen for you to order from, wasn't none of that going on. You couldn't get it off of Amazon. You had to wait for the boat to come in with your shipment. And you got that good silk, that good thing. They done took some time and spun that cocoon's web or that caterpillar silk into a fine fabric. And not only did they spin it, they took the time to dye it into the colors of royalty. So this says that as she makes herself coverings of tapestry, her clothing is silk and purple. That means that she recognizes that she is fearfully and wonderfully made, and she's covered because she's a queen. She don't have to have nobody tell it, because if you leave it up to somebody else, you'll never hear it. But when you begin to look at this, you know that you're a queen. You know that God has blessed you. You know that God has elevated you. You know that God loves you. You know that he treats you just as you call yourself. You are a queen. I need you to look at yourself sometimes. I know you're trying to figure out if you got all the eyes, don't got the corner of your eye, but you need to look at yourself sometimes in your phone and say, good morning, queen. I'm just happy that I'm here on this morning. Good morning, queen. And you're going to have a great day today. Sometimes you have to acknowledge what you haven't heard in order for you to walk in what you need to be. She clothes herself in silk and in purple because she's a queen. Brother Jason, I'm just walking through a few things right here, so I know you got somewhere to be, but hang out with us for a few minutes and I'll get you on out the door. Amen. So when you look at it, her husband is known at the gates. He sits among the elders of the land. Her husband, this particular woman's husband, goes about his life knowing that what's at home is taken care of. He takes care of what he needs to take care of because she takes care of what she needs to take care of. Can you say amen? Everybody want to hear that. Everybody want the relationship that Big Mama and them had, but you don't want to make no chicken like Big Mama did. Amen? Can't make a biscuit unless the can popping. Amen? Can't make no cornbread unless that blue box come down. Oh, Lord Jesus. Everybody want what the grandparents and them had. You want to sit there, how long am I supposed to cook this roast on the stove? First off, you done made mistakes already. You done put the doggone roast on the stove. Get you a slow cooker. Get you something to say, Betty Crocker, give yourself 8 to 10 hours. Let that thing get succulent and tender. But you want to get the blessings of granddaddy coming in and being able to hand you over his check to make sure the bills was paid. But you ain't home when he get home because you're too busy turning it up. We're talking about a godly woman. I'm trying to set you back on the right path if you're off the path. You too busy turning it up. You at the white party, the black party. You would have took the day off, ain't telling nobody there was a day party. You done sat there and said, Sirach got a brand new drink. I'm gonna go out and test that at Mothers and Sons. I'm gonna do all of this and that and the other. You was out there with your little outfit on. Can I just share something with you? There's so many people that went to the concert but didn't bring their butt to church. And how do I know? Because y'all don't know how to stay off social media. Amen. You gonna post it up there. I'm like, that's you 60 years old. That's not a godly outfit. That's not of God what you're wearing right there. That's trying to get a man, but that's not of God. Amen. So this is what you gotta look at. You gotta put yourself in the right position. If your husband is known when he's in the gates and sitting among the elders, that's because he's secure enough to go do that while you're handling the things of the household. Amen. See, it's not popular, but it's the Bible. You can't argue, you know. Now, I'm not saying that women can't go out and work. Of course, go out and work. Most of our lifestyles require 2, if not 3 incomes nowadays, right? But recognize that we have roles and responsibilities that we have to be able to maintain. Most women who want to be godly women can't get rid of the independence of saying, I don't need a man, but God has put a man in your life for you to be able to be covered according to the word of God. Can we just talk about that for a minute? We want to get out of that. I don't need no man, but when something happened, you want a man there to try to handle it. If you got a spider, how many of y'all scared of spiders? Be honest. Y'all ain't scared of spiders? You scared of spiders? Thank you for your honesty, sis. You can tell the truth in here. Y'all acting like, I'm going to tell you somebody that's deathly afraid of spiders. Sandy. Terrified of spider, will not go into a room, there's a spider. You are 157 times bigger than that spider, but she will not go into a room. She said, can y'all kill the spider? Something as small as that, you know, holds precedence. Let me ask y'all another question. How many of y'all wonderful ladies like seeing these little brown mice running around your house? Does it make you nervous? Now, wouldn't it be, it makes you nervous? Okay. See, that's a little bit better. And if there's a man in the house, you don't want him standing on the chair next to you, do you? Because what you there for? What, he's standing on the chair next to you? He's like, are you going to get it? No, you need to unhook that PS5, get them ramen noodles out of there, and you tell him go back to his mama's house. Amen? Because you're of no value to me right now. But we get involved in these situations. We want him taking care of what him have to take care of, but we not going to take care of what we need to take care of. No, we all need to take care of everything together. Amen? Amen. So when he sits in the elders of the land, he's known, and she makes her linen, she sells it, she delivers things to the merchants. This is talking about her business acumen. Strength and honor are her clothing. Strength and honor. Godly woman is honorable. It's what the Bible says. Godly woman is honorable, and she rejoices in the time to come, meaning that when she begins to look at her life, all she anticipates is great things. There's a song. Who sings that song that I love to sing that y'all don't let me sing in the house? Great things. Who sings that song? Prashia Hilliard. She says, I'm expecting great things in my life. You do great things. In my home, you do great things. Eyes haven't seen the great things that you're going to do. So that's why they don't let me sing it, because I forget the lyrics. But strength and honor, and she looks with expectancy at the time to come. She's not afraid of what happens. When she opens her mouth, she speaks from a point of wisdom.
point of wisdom, and her tongue is a law of kindness. Here's what we have to begin to look at, and this is why I say I'm not a fan of reality television. When you look at the wives and the husbands on reality television, some of these women have some of the filthiest mouths I've ever heard in my life. Filthy. Some of the men, you know, if you haven't been in the Navy, you have no reason to cuss like a sailor. You know, now, all of us slip up from time to time. But every word out your mouth shouldn't be how Bill Cosby used to say it, filth and florin and florin and filth. Everything out your mouth shouldn't be nasty, right? Your tongue has a law of kindness. Everything shouldn't be a bitter word. There should be some kindness coming out of you. And you have wisdom. You know, nobody is gonna, no one should be steering somebody incorrect just for being nasty, okay? I gotta share that with you. The Bible says she opens her mouth with wisdom. When you give somebody something, if you're talking to somebody, let there be wisdom that comes forth out of your mouth. Let there be good things that come forth out of your mouth. Let kindness come out of your mouth. Amen? Amen. This is, we're talking about hallmarks of a godly mother. She looks to her household and she don't just sit around eating bonbons. Y'all remember Married with Children? And what was the Katie Sagal's character? Peggy. Sitting on the couch with some leopard whatever she had on, eating bonbons. Kids sitting there trying to get toaster leavings at the bottom of the toaster while she eating bonbons. She going out shopping, but she always had on the same thing, sitting on the same spot on the couch. Couch done probably, the upholstery done probably wore down because she's sitting in the same spot eating bonbons. The Bible says that she has not eaten the bread of idleness, okay? And because of all of these things, as we're talking about on Mother's Day, her children arise, her children get up. When they look in, they say, good morning, mother. You are so blessed. They say, good morning, mother. You are the righteousness of God. I'm thankful for you in my life. We don't recognize until we get older the value of the mothers that we have in our life. Can I just share that with you? Some of the worst offenders are the individuals from the age of 13 to, I would say, 25. The worst offenders of not appreciating your mothers. Because during that time, you think that you don't need your mother because you're trying to navigate this on your own. But as the song says, you get one mama, you get one. I was thinking last night, I was in my office and my mother's ashes are in my office. And I'm thinking it had to be about 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning, what I would give to be able to hear one of those corny jokes again, because you get one mother. What I would give at 1:46 in the morning on my birthday to wake up to someone singing off key because I was born at 1:46 in the morning and she never let me forget it. What I would give to be able to pass information back and forth and to begin to encourage her as she got older, the teacher became the student became the teacher, and I began to talk to her about forgiveness and the righteousness of God and planning for where you're going to go, because many of us have many more years behind us than we have ahead of us. And I began to pour into her, but what I wouldn't give to have one of those conversations yet again. So those offenders between the age of 13 and 25 don't recognize that. But while her children are able to still recognize that, they rise up and they call her blessed. Her husband also praises her. Her husband also says that you are the righteousness of God. I'm going to tell you this. If you're in a relationship and your husband does not at least at some point wake up and call you beautiful at some point, you know, doesn't say, hey, you look real good today. If he don't look at you with the same way he looked at when he was chasing you, in some capacity, regardless of what's changed in your life, then there's something that y'all need to talk about. Amen? Amen. You know, Pastor Ella will look at me, and I'll tell her, I say, hey, I got up this morning, went upstairs, I said, oh, you look nice. Really? Yeah, that's why I said it, because you look nice. What you thought? Yeah, really. You know, because to me, even though we are 17 years removed from where we met in front of Mrs. Fields Cookies, I still recognize that she is the righteousness of God. I still praise her when she does things that, you know, like if things go well, or she makes progress in the area, or if something shifts in her life, I say, we celebrate what you've done so far.
You may not be where you need to be, but thank God you're not where you used to be. Many of us need to look at our wives, our husbands, our daughters, our sons. We need to look at our ministries and say, we're not where we used to be, and we thank God for that. We may not be where we need to be at yet, but thank God we're not still wrapped up in the mess that we used to be wrapped up in. Thank God we're not still wrapped up in the brokenness. Thank God we're not still wrapped up in the turmoil. Thank God we're not still wrapped up in this miry clay. Thank God we're not still wrapped up in this mindset. Thank God we're not still wrapped up in these issues. Thank God we're not still wrapped up in such a way that God can look at us and say, I don't even know who you are. Thank God we're not still wrapped up in that mess. So you ought to praise. Many daughters have done virtuously, but you excel them all. Many times when we look at our lives, we want to always talk to situations. We don't want to talk about what God says about us. We don't want to talk about it because ultimately when you begin to look at it, we're not really sure exactly whether we're saying or doing the right thing. But I'm here to tell you today, I gave you an example. Cut mic one off for me, Keith, if you don't mind. I'm here to give you an example that when you begin to look at your life and you look at your life as a woman, you look at your life as a mother, I'm here to tell you today that as long as you're in a position where you're walking in the blessings of God, as long as you're in a position where you're honoring God with all of your steps, as long as you're in a position where God is getting the glory out of all of your life, as long as you're doing the things that God has called for you to do, this is what I need you to recognize. This is what I need you to see, that God is going to bless the fruit of your lips. God is going to bless the fruit of your womb when you walk according to what God has purposed in your life, when you walk according to what God has designed for you, when you walk according to it, when you walk the steps of a godly mother, when you walk the steps of a godly woman, God is going to order your steps. God is going to bless your hands. God is going to bless the fruit of your lips. God is going to bless you in ways you can't comprehend. So when you look back over your life and you realize that God is the reason you got over, when you look back over your life, you realize he's the reason why you've been kept. When you look back over your life, you realize that God is the reason. He's your Alpha, your Omega. When you look back over your life, you know that God has had you at every step of the way. You know that God is going to keep your children. He's going to bless your finances. When you look back over your life, you say, God, if you did it before, I'll know you'll do it again. When you look back over your life, you can say, God, you've been a blessing day in and day out. When you look back over your life, oh yeah, when you look back over your life, you realize that God has been a keeper. When you look back over your life, you realize that God has been a way maker. When you look back over your life, you know he made a promise and he's a promise keeper. When you look back over your life, he's been a bridge over troubled water. When you look back over your life, he's been your bright and guiding star. When you look back over your life, he's been the one in whose direction you follow. When you look back over your life, you know that God is your everything. Oh, but sometimes you gotta look back. Because where you're at right now, you may not be able to see it. But when you look back over your life, you see his hand on you. You may not be able to see it when you're in your turmoil. But when you look back, you say, God, pull me out. When you look back over your life, you begin to see things differently. So I encourage you, sisters, on this day, look back over your life. You may have some areas of opportunity for you to get to what this says. Nobody is perfect. Nobody walking this earth is. But I'm telling you right now, if you trust in the Lord, if you lean not to your own understanding, if you acknowledge him in all your ways, he will direct your path. But sometimes you got to look back. Oh, sometimes you got to look back. Because if you don't look back, you don't know how far you come. You can look at your life and say, God, I'm so upset that I'm not where I need to be at right now. But when you look back, when you started up here and you couldn't see the goal line, when you started up here and you couldn't see the top of the staircase, when you started up here and you couldn't see your way out, when you started up here and you thought that all hope was lost, when you started up here and you didn't know what direction to go, but the closer you began to walk with God, it got a little bit clearer. The path got a little bit wider. The closer you began to walk with God, the more he began to direct your path. The closer you began to walk with God, the more he began to walk with you. And that's like Mother Nikki Hooks would always say, I want Jesus to walk with me. While I'm on this tedious journey, I need Jesus to walk with me. Hold my hand, Lord. Hold my hand. Hold my hand, Lord, because sometimes I get scared. Hold my hand, Lord. Sometimes I gotta do it afraid. Hold my hand, Lord. Sometimes I don't know the right way. Hold my hand, Lord. I need you to walk with me. But sometimes you gotta look back. Because if you don't look back, You forget where you came from. Oh, don't forget where you came from today. Don't forget where God brought you from today. You may not be where you need to be yet, but oh, thank God, you're not where you used to be. I look back and I say, thank you, God, for pulling me out. I'm pressing up the King's highway. I'm still pressing. Paul said, even though I have not attained it yet, I press. So on today, I encourage you, press your way. Don't give up. Don't give in. Press your way. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise in this place this morning. Everyone standing to your feet. Everyone standing to your feet. We're about to get up out of the chair. Amen. I want to take this time to pray. I want to pray with you right now. Because here's the thing that we have to look at. Yesterday is gone. Today is fast fleeting. But tomorrow is not promised. I don't want you to leave here today not knowing God as the pardoner of your sin. I don't want you to leave here today without having connection to a church home. I don't want you to leave here today without having been connected to the kingdom. I don't want you to leave here today the same way you came in here today. I don't want you to leave here today not having a relationship with God. So we're going to pray, but as we begin to move through this ask and this offer of connection, I want you to begin to think about where you are. Begin to think about what you're doing. Begin to think about where God has moved in your life that you may have forgotten, but he's showing you that he's still a skillful way maker. So every eye is closed and every head is bowed at this moment. And we're going to pray. Father, we thank you this morning. Father, we thank you because you've been so good. Oh, Father, you've been better to us than we've been to ourselves. You've been good to us and we don't deserve it. You've been good to us and sometimes we'll walk away. Father, but you've still been good to us. You've been so good to us because you loved us first. You loved us so much you sent your son through 42 generations to be born into a messed up situation, born into a virgin so man cannot take credit, to be born to die for our sins. He lived his life 33 and a third years to be able to make his way, to feel what we felt, to navigate what we have to navigate. We have not such a great high priest that the sins of man are not common. So we have a high priest that recognizes what we've been through. My brother, my sister, you are not going through anything that somebody else has not gone through. But going through alone is tumultuous. Going through alone is turmoil. Going through alone is a tragedy you don't have to endure. So I encourage you on today, if you've never given your life to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, let today be the day that you change your life. Let today be the day that you look back and say, I yield. What must I do to be saved? Let today be that day that you say, you know what? I've been doing this on my own. I've tried over and over and over, but I've learned that there is no other way that I can live without you. Give your life to Christ today. Let your life be changed and transformed on today. Or maybe you've given your life to Christ, you have good relationship with God, but the problem becomes that you don't have a church home. You've been going from place to place. You've been wandering from door to door, from pew to pew, and you've been trying to find somewhere where it spoke to your very existence. I'm here to tell you today that a connected church is good ground, amen? Oh, let me say that again. Connected church is good ground, amen? There's a word in the house for those that would listen, that would be transforming for their lives. There's a word in the house for those that will receive. So if you don't have a church home today, I encourage you to connect to the church on today. Yesterday is gone, tomorrow, today is fleeting, and tomorrow is not promised. Let today be the day that you settle down and say that you recognize that only the trees that are planted by the water will flourish. Or maybe you've never been baptized. You've never gone under the water, died to the old to be reborn into the newness of Christ. If any of these things are your portion, to where you've never given your life to Christ, or you've given your life to Christ, but you don't have a church home, or you need to connect to the kingdom, I'm going to ask that you would make your way to this, the altar. Even though this is a smaller church, sometimes that walk can be the longest walk in the earth. Because you're making a choice and a decision that would change and shape the destiny and direction of your life. So if that is your portion, you would make your way here. Or ensure on this Mother's Day that you would talk with one of the elders and leaders of the church. If you have questions, we have answers. We may not have all the answers, but the answers we do have, we give you as we give you the love of the Lord. Every eye is closed, every head is bowed. This is not a time for anything else. This is a time that we're praying. Somebody's life is on the line. This is a time that we're praying. This is a time that we're looking at the Word of God and letting it line up in our lives. And the people of God would say, amen, amen, and amen. Again, give the Lord a hand clap of praise in this place. I know I kept you a little bit longer than normal. But God had something he needed to say to you this morning. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. At this time, we're going to give you your closing prayer and your benediction. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'm going to ask that the ladies, please don't run out rushing. Again, that's why we have security measures such as grates in place, so you don't run out rushing. Amen. The Bible tells you clearly, as we begin to look at his text, and it's out of Jeremiah 29, picking up where we left off at 11 and just taking it to 12. Then shall you call upon me, and you shall go and pray unto me, and I will hearken unto you. You shall seek me and find me, and when you search for me with all your heart, and I will be found of you, saith the Lord, and will turn away your captivity and gather you from all the nations and from all the places whither I have driven you, saith the Lord. And I'll bring you again to the place whence I caused you to be carried away. God is looking to bring everyone back to where they need to be. Amen. That's the reason for the kingdom of God being as vast as it is. So I encourage you, as we get ready to depart from this place, that you would recognize that God is pulling you back. Let's pray. Father, we thank you right now for everything that you've done so far, for everything that you're going to do, for having your way on today, particularly on this Mother's Day, as we looked at what a godly mother, what her hallmarks are. And we thank you at this time that you are able to still speak in your house to your people. Father, as we leave this place, never dismiss us from your presence. Keep us protected, keep us guided, keep us connected. Keep us in the hollow of your hand as the apple of your eye. Now may the grace of God and sweet communion with the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide, not just now, but forevermore.